Good morning, church. We are so grateful you have chosen St. Charles as your place to celebrate Palm Sunday. At this time, I'd like to invite you all to please silence your cell phones, leave your belongings at your seats, grab your palms, and head outside to the front of the church where we will begin our Mass.
Move a little further over this way.
Yeah.
Because they're all getting crammed in there. Should I say something?
No.
I mean,
that's fine. Let the ushers do it. They're happy to open them.
Oh, are they out there? Oh,
the audience? Right there, the
oh, there you go.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't know. He said who's going to cue me to start. I said, I don't know.
I believe we'll just... Do you want to cue us?
Do you want to cue
ready?
Us? I don't know.
Father's right here.
I could ask him.
Not that I want to. Right. So we go like around. Yeah. All
right. Oh, he's right there.
Around the kids. We must go that way. Then we'll follow you.
This was not supposed to be a path.
Right. I know.
Hold it. I gotta turn up the sound.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, Jim.
Dear friends, brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts with fasting, prayer, reaching out in charity and justice, and journeying with our elect as they prepare for the sacraments of initiation. Today we come together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery. The specific actions that saved us, the suffering, death, and resurrection of Christ. It was to accomplish this mystery that Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem for the last time. Therefore, with faith and devotion, let us commemorate this entry of our Savior into the city, following his footsteps so that, being made partakers of the cross, we may also share in the resurrection and eternal life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I now invite all of you to raise your palm branches for blessing. Almighty and ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ, the King in exaltation, may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite of you, and immediately upon entering it, you'll find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why you are doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it and will send it back here at once.'" So they went off and found a colt tethered at a gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They answered them, just as Jesus had told them to, and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him as well as those kept crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest." The gospel of the Lord.
On this Palm Sunday, we reflect on Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Let us remember the symbolism of the palms that were waved in adoration. They were not just signs of celebration, but also reminds of the fleeting nature of earthly glory. Just as the crowds hailed Jesus as king one day, and cried out for his crucifixion the next, we too can be fickle in our faith. As we carry palm branches today, let them serve as a reminder of our own journey with Christ. Are we merely followers in times of joy and prosperity? Or do we remain steadfast even in the face of adversity? Let us not be like the crowds who easily sway with the changing winds of the world, but instead let us anchor our faith in the unchanging love and mercy of our Savior. May this Palm Sunday inspire us to walk alongside Jesus, not only in times of celebration, but also in moments of trial and suffering. Let us lay down our own palm branches, symbols of our own desires and ambitions, and instead pick up our own cross daily, following the example of Christ with unwavering devotion and humility. At this time, we have the procession into the church with the palms waving. For the order of the procession, first we have the cross and the altar seva, followed by the choir members, and behind the choir members will be the congregation. Thank you.
And as we possess, remember to wave your palms as they did as a king entered that city.
Oh,
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patience and suffering. Through our participation in this celebration, may we align our passion and struggle with the passion of Christ, so that we may share in his resurrection. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. At this time, we invite our children for the liturgy of the word. So what is special today? Huh?
It's Palm Sunday.
Okay, Palm Sunday. What do we remember on Palm Sunday? Anybody knows? What are we remembering?
Jesus
entry to Jerusalem. Yes, Jesus' entry to Jerusalem. The beginning of Jesus' work of redemption in a special way. His suffering, death and resurrection that we celebrate especially. Triduum. Have you heard the word triduum? Anybody has heard that word triduum? Triduum means what? It means 3 days. The 3 days are Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Vigil, Easter Day. So we are going to celebrate all that, and we want to pray together for all our children. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of all our children. We ask you to bless them, that they may grow up to be good Christians and honest citizens, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear. And I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard, my face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore, I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Please be seated. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
"Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people."
While he was in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at table, a woman with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard came. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
"Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii, and that money given to the poor."
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray them to him. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, says to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out for the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and say to one after the other,
"Surely, not I."
And he said to them,
It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread. After blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said,
Take, this is my body.
Then he took a cup. After giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
This is the blood of my covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
You will all become deserters, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
Even though all become deserters, I will not.
Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he said vehemently,
Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
All of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane. He said to his disciples,
Sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them,
I am deeply grieved even to death. Remain here and keep awake.
And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want.
He came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away on the guard.
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said,
Rabbi.
and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. And Jesus said to them,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled."
All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at a fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false witness against him, saying,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy the temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'"
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before him and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
The high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? We have heard this blasphemy. What is your decision?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying,
"Prophesy."
The guards took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you're talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it. Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly, you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse and swore an oath,
"I do not know this man you are talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times.
And he broke down and wept.
Oh,
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus and led him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you?"
But Jesus made no further reply. So Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man named Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over to them. But the chief priests stirred the crowd up to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again.
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head and began to salute him.
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down to pay homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry the cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Ah, you who destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard this, they said,
"Listen, he's calling for Elijah."
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, and put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink.
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come down to take him down."
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. Let us stand and bow. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when a centurion who was standing facing him saw that he had breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." There were also women looking on from a distance, among them Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the Younger, and of Joseph and Salome. Though these followed him and provided him for him when he was in Galilee, and there were many other women who had come along with Jesus to Jerusalem. When evening came, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoned the centurion and asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb which had been hewn out of rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
At this time, we ask all of you to be seated and spend a few moments in silence, thanking God, thanking Jesus for bringing us salvation and making us children of heaven. At this time, we have the sending off the RCIA members. My dear friends, this community now sends you forth to reflect more deeply upon the Word of God which you have shared with us today. Be assured of our loving support and prayers for you. We look forward to the day when you will share fully at the Lord's table. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand for the prayers of the faithful. Jesus cries out to God in his time of need. With the trust that God listens to our prayers, let us bring our needs before the Lord.
For the church, that she celebrates the liturgies of this holiest week of the year with sincerity and solemnity, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For government leaders, that they recognize the people and places suffering and in need of a new life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are sick in this community of faith, may they come to know the healing consolation of Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our catechumen and the elect who are preparing themselves to receive the sacraments of initiation, may the grace of the Holy Spirit fill their lives with abundant blessings, and may they empty themselves to rise with Christ in this new life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our community of faith, that we renew our commitment to living as Jesus' disciples this Holy Week. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have died with hope in the promise of Christ, may God shed his mercy and peace upon them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the parishioners of St. Charles Borromeo, for whom we offer this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the intentions written in our Book of Intercessions and all those we hold in the silence of our heart, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We make all these prayers and petitions through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Jesus, and your resurrection.
pray, dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us now offer one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Behold Jesus, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be with the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Invite our Eucharistic ministers to the homebound to come up. We shall pray together. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of all our Eucharistic ministers, especially those who serve the sick and the homebound. Bless them and the ministries they do and the people they serve. In the name of the Father, Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We do not have any special announcements except invitation to all to attend our Triduum, the three special holy days for our religion. First, we have Holy Thursday. The services are at 7 p.m. Good Friday, we have services at 12 p.m. or 12 noon for the Stations of the Cross. Good Friday, it will be at 7 p.m. Holy Saturday, that is Easter Vigil, at 8 p.m. We also have morning prayers on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday at 8:30 a.m. in our chapel. So we invite everyone to participate in all these holy celebrations and experience God's love and compassion and mercy and grow closer to God and each other. Please stand. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Now we shall be, thanks be to God.
Good.
We shall be processing out in silence. There will be no concluding hymn. Thank you.